Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to tonight's Common Council meeting. Before we ask our city clerk to read the quote for the week, I'd like to take just a couple of seconds to thank all the public that, when I go out into the public and talk to people, they've always telling me, we watch the council every Monday. So all those people are out there watching us, thank you very much. In particular, John Vandermill, who religiously watches the council meetings and offers a lot of advice and suggestions. We will go to the quote of the week.
Thank you. Keeping score of old scores and scars, getting even and one-upping always makes you less than you are.
Thank you very much. Call the 8th regular meeting of the Common Council to order. Please call the roll.
Boren.
Here.
Bauck.
Excuse.
Decker.
Here.
Gisha.
Here.
Hannah.
Here.
Heidemann.
Here.
Kittleson.
Here.
Kleunis.
Here.
Meyer.
Here.
Montemayor.
Here.
Rindfleisch.
Here.
Ryan.
Here.
Surik.
Here.
Vanderweel.
Here.
Verhasselt.
Here.
And Wongeman.
Here.
15 present.
Quorum is present. Alderman Heidemann, would you please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Alderman Heidemann. Next item on the agenda is approval of the minutes. President Hannah.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move to approve the minutes.
Second.
Motion and second to approve minutes. Under discussion? There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Minutes stand approved. Mayor's appointments. Attorney McLean.
Honorable members of the council, I hereby submit the following appointments for your consideration to the Sustainable Sheboygan Task Force. Alderman Gene Kleunis, Alderman Vicki Meyer, David Beeble, Paulette Enders, Jim Hulbert, John Hill, Thomas Grittinger, Scott Hansen, Thomas Henning, Sarah Thiel, Ted Vallis, Pat Hartley, Vicki Hall, Dirk Zeileman, Reagan Howlati, Jeffrey Goins, Sue Bissing, and Aaron Brault. All appointed to be appointed 7/21/08, terms expiring 4/20/09, signed by the mayor.
These appointments will lie over. Just as a point of explanation here, when we have representatives from a particular entity, for example, the Sheboygan County Government, Area School Board, UW Sheboygan, Chamber of Commerce, et cetera, we actually call them and ask them who they would like to nominate as a member representing them. That's how those numbers names got here. Those appointments will lie over. Thank you very much, Attorney McLean. Next item on the agenda is a public forum. Madam City Clerk.
First on the list is Catherine Schnurr. Is Catherine here tonight?
No, she's not here.
She's not here. Okay, next on the list would be Henry Capitillo. Henry, can you give me your home address, please?
Yes, that's 1619 North 38th Street, and that's in the town of Sheboygan.
And you will have 5 minutes.
Thank you. Over the past week or so, I have been reading various news articles and an editorial regarding the anticipated City of Sheboygan budget deficit. According to the Sheboygan Press, some alderpersons believe the deficit will be over $2 million. The mayor says it's too early to throw out numbers regarding the deficit because we don't know. It should not surprise anyone that City of Sheboygan is or will be facing a budget deficit. I personally heard the City of Sheboygan would be having a budget deficit in the fall of 2007, and at that time it was projected to be over $1 million. City officials and elected officials should be operating in a heightened cost-saving mode since they already know that over the past several years, spending levels have far exceeded revenue levels. Both federal and state funding to municipalities have also decreased steadily over the past years. Taxpayers are also seeing costs going out of proportion in such items as automobile fuel, utility costs, gas and light, food, housing, and medical. But at the same time, their wages are staying at the same level. How many of you have heard the saying, spending or living within your means? What this means is that you should only spend money that you have and not money that you think you might have. How many of us have gone out and purchased something because you say to yourself, well, my tax return will be much more this year than I can afford, so I can afford to spend the money now and be able to pay it later, only to get a surprise when you don't get what you anticipated to have? How many times have we seen the council approve spending when some other persons knew that the city were operating at a deficit? How many times has the mayor hired non-union staff at between $10,000 to $15,000 above the starting salary? You hear, well, this is what it takes for someone to live in the city of Sheboygan because of the residency requirement. Not too long ago, the council and the mayor were talking about going to Germany again this year. Didn't the mayor and the city officials go to Germany a year ago? You hear, well, the money will come from other sources and some of the individuals will pay for their own expense. Do not make excuses to spend money that you do not have, but be consistent in cutting spending. Over the past year, I have said that city officials and elected officials should look at what impact their vote on various issues will have in the short term and in the long term. Approving spending today may have a far-reaching effect a year or two down the line. If you want to cut costs, do it consistently, and not just when it is something that you do not support and your opposition does. Do not approve spending for fire department. Do not approve spending for the fire department and then deny spending for the police department. Be consistent in your ability to hold the line on spending and live within your means. I commend Alderman Gisha and Alderman Hanna for their willingness to be upfront with the taxpayers of Sheboygan and to voice their concern about the city's budget deficit, and also to include various measures that they think would be recommended to the council to limit or eliminate the deficit. The first step in solving a problem is to admit that you do have a problem. By taking the initiative to look at the problem now, you will avoid putting yourself in a position that you will have less options down the line to resolve the deficit issue. I also commend Alderman Bourne and Verhassel for their efforts to look into shared services with the county in order to save money for the city and to reduce additional costs. As for the hiring freeze, I think it is a good idea to start, but I would look at what impact this will have on various departments. Specifically, I would say the police department. If we're looking that we are already understaffed and we're looking to put a freeze on the positions, what's going to happen when you really do need to hire additional officers? I would hope that there be some options made available for the council to approve various positions that would be needed, that would be critical for the city. And I would say especially for the police department. As for all the other measures that were presented, I think they are a good idea, and I think that some of the older persons should be commended for their initiative to look at this and to say, you know what, we have a problem now, let's deal with it. Let's not just put it away and then look at what might happen down the line. I know that every year we get to this point where it's coming towards the end of the year where all of a sudden you start hearing, well, we're going to have less money, we're going to have a deficit, and there's always some of the older persons that are putting out initiatives of what they might do to solve that issue. I'm happy to see that at this point that the council is looking at this seriously.
Would you like your additional minute?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
And to actively discuss the issues that are going to be presented at hand of how you could resolve the issues of the deficit and how you can handle this in a manner that it is best for the best interest of the taxpayers of Sheboygan. And again, I would commend the older persons that are looking at this and are seriously looking to do something about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And last this evening is David Lipsky. And David, excuse me, could you give me your home address, please?
131 Lincoln Avenue.
And you will have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you. Okay, I'm here tonight as a citizen and a taxpayer. And since I only have 6 minutes to talk, or actually five, I'd like to get it done at five, let me get straight to the issues of concern. First, I'm here tonight with a challenge to grow Sheboygan. I would like to see the City Council focus its policies toward the establishment of sustainable growth in terms of jobs and real estate development. Growth is the only sustainable way, is the only way to sustain the city's viability as a partner with business, ensuring continued investment by its citizens. Over the past year, I invested over $30,000 in my home on the north side of the city. However, after such investment, I'm starting to think I should have invested my money in a growing community such as the town of Sheboygan or another city such as Plymouth or Manitowoc. I personally know of numerous individuals who moved outside the city of Sheboygan to flee its seemingly increasing state of decline. The streets and residential neighborhoods are in need of repair, and the lack of tree planting is shedding new light on this deterioration. No pun intended. As this blight becomes more and more evident, Sheboygan citizens will continue to move to growth areas. The proof is obvious. Town of Sheboygan, Apple Valley, Manitowoc, or the one small town of Waukesha. We need a success story similar to that of Manitowoc. And I've got a document here that's basically going to be a transcript of what I'm reading, and I'd like to hand it out to everybody because there's been recent articles to include, I think, a week or so ago in the Wall Street Journal about what Manitowoc is doing. Second, the City Council needs to adopt a means to increase understanding and awareness of the city budget as it relates to Sheboygan taxpayers. In other words, the citizens need to understand that the vast majority of their property tax goes to the county for social services, not city services. Without a full understanding of the situation, homeowners can misdirect their energies, which may result in less city services while their tax bill continues to increase. The proposed resolution to cut the city tax from $8.42 per $1,000 of assessed value to $8.37 per $1,000 of assessed value could save the average homeowner a whopping $6. However, with no control over the other taxing authorities, the average homeowner may still see an increase. It should be noted that while the City of Sheboygan has no control over the other taxing authorities, it does have control over citywide growth, which provides part of the revenue used to help fund other taxing agencies. Third, the council should develop a method to understand departmental performance and material utilization before mandating blind cuts in the city budget that affect service to citizens. And at this time, you know, what I'm trying to do here is I realize the budgets are tight. But on a short term, you can make cuts. But I'm looking at, you know, my children. I'd like my children to live in Sheboygan someday. I left Sheboygan because there wasn't a lot of job opportunities for me here. That has not changed in 30 years. And I think part of it is before I came up here, you can easily get into this, let's look at cuts, let's look at cuts, and there's nothing wrong with that. I'm all for optimization. But I think somewhere there has to be a plan to say, look at how are we going to do some other things here. And there's nothing wrong with looking at other benchmarks, other communities that have done it. So with that said, I have even a little side note, and I didn't do it. I was going to bring in an example of my curbing. I got it in my office. I really brought it over for engineering to look at because I don't understand it. But it's all, you know, my whole neighborhood is falling apart, and I have a big chunk of it with me here. And I put all this money into my house. But if you look up and down my streets, the curbing is all imploding. So I even said here, so eventually I'm going to feel like I live in the town of Sheboygan where they don't have curbs. People who care about their community don't want to live in neighborhoods of disrepair. So I'm just trying to move the focus from let's not cut too deep, be fiscally responsible, but also balance that with the services. Like, for example, I'd like to see some new street development. I'd like to see more trees developed. I think last year I had some statistic that we planted, somebody told me, like 14 trees. You know, how many did we lose in this recent storm? And if you want to make a neighborhood look bad, remove the trees. I mean, people will move and they don't know why. And I see it over on the south side of town. I drive through there and I see the parts of the south side kind of running down. And if you look around, there's no trees over there. Trees make a big difference. So I'm going to hand this out. The big thing was I've been amazed with what's going on in Manitowoc. And you know what? I think we can do the same thing here. You know, we have the same resources. We have the same hardworking, good people. I just wanted to spend 5 minutes because I just felt that there was so much talk of cutting that there had to be another side to it other than that. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
We can pass them out at the end. Just leave them there. We'll get them out.
That's it.
Okay. Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda is the mayor's comments. I'll be talking a little bit about the budget committee. Council committee roles and responsibilities, and then the code enforcer, which we've talked about over and over again. But Before I talk on the budget, I'd like to preface my talk with a quotation by Josh Billings. And he said, the problem with people is not they don't, that they know so much. The problem with people is that they know so much that ain't so. And sometimes we run into that when we talk about the budget. We don't have a budget deficit, folks. Council, you know that. We balanced our budget 3 times last year. And I'll say it again for the people. We do not have a budget deficit this year. The impression is we have a deficit right now. We don't have a budget deficit next year. We haven't done a budget. We have expenses that have accrued, that are adding up in addition to what we spent last year. But if having more expenses means you have a deficit, every municipality, school district, and county have a deficit as we speak. They have increased expenses too. And all a budget is what is your revenues and what are your expenses and do they match? If they don't, then you've got a deficit after you pass the budget and you don't have enough revenue to meet your expenses. You have a deficit. So the sky is not falling. We don't have a budget deficit. We're working very hard on our budget. It's all preliminary. I would like to tell you a little bit about our anticipated sources of revenue and then work our way down to the breakdown of the levy, anticipated general operating budget, and so forth. But if we look now at our anticipated sources of revenue, for the longest time, state revenue sharing has been about 46%. Our tax levy has been 41%. That's 87% of our general operating budget, or our levy. Our levy, not general operating. That means that the state controls 87% of our budget, effectively. They don't give us any more revenue sharing. They limit your levy by 2%, 2.5%, or your growth, whichever is larger. They, in effect, control 87% of our levy. The other sources of revenue is interest on investments, fund equity applied, licenses and permits, fines and forfeitures. And we have other little bitty things that come around and gives us money so that we can meet our expenditures. Now keep in mind, we only have so much revenue, and our expenses, after we budget or after we balance our budget, will go up next year. They didn't just go up this year or last year. They will continue to go up every single year from here on, till you're done being a member, until I'm done being a mayor. The state further controls our budget by expenditure restraints, which is good, which is bad. They've decreased the rate on manufacturing. I don't know if any of you will recall last year we had to come back with about $385,000 because they knocked it down 5%. We have no control over the assessments on manufacturing. The state does. They decrease our transportation aids. These are things we have no control over. These are things you as aldermen cannot pass a resolution and say we're going to get more. And you're certainly not going to get more from the tax levy, because the only way to get more than 2.5% or growth, whichever is larger, is to do a referendum. I can bet on what people are going to tell you on that one. They're going to tell you flat out no. Now, we've looked at our anticipated sources of revenue. Where is our money coming from? That's where it's coming from. How do we break it down in terms of the city tax levy? Where does it really go? 67% of all that money goes to our general operations. That's everything the government does here, our city government. 17 goes to debt service. That's the money we borrow, we have to pay back. We have to appropriate that separately. 13% goes to the library fund. We give the money in appropriation so that they can stay in operation. 3% go to transit. That's how the breakdown of the tax levy is. So again, 67% and 17 comes in for us. The rest goes to the library and the transit. People ask, oh, you have all this money, where's it going? That's where it's going. Our anticipated general operating budget for next year will be about $36, $37 million. That doesn't include the library fund and the transit. I'm talking about general operations. Now, if that's how it's broken generally, how is it broken down specifically when we look at departments in the city? I'll tell you. Police gets 32%. 32. So every time I hear we're not adequately providing funds for the police, I don't know where people are getting these numbers from. 32%, that's about a third of our budget that goes to police. Public Works gets the next big chunk. 21% goes to Public Works. Fire, 20%. So if you look at police and fire, which is regarded as public protection and safety, more than half of our budget is appropriated to public protection and safety. Folks, if that's not doing our job, I don't know what is. We take very good care of our police officers, police department, and our fire department. If you hear otherwise, it ain't so. No pun intended. Overplaying this. Administrative, 17%. Parks and Senior Center, for all of you who do not know, we do appropriate for the Senior Center, the Senior Activity Center. 9% goes to that. And then we generally try a 1% contingency, and that can go either way. So we know what where our revenue comes from, we know how we're breaking down in general terms, and we know where specifically is going per department. Now, I hear people, Mayor, quit raising my taxes. Mayor, I'm paying too much in taxes. And I keep saying it, and I will keep saying it till I get blue in the face. 32.1% of every dollar everybody pays out there comes to the city. We're not getting it all, folks. We're not getting that whole dollar you pay. 32.1%. That's all we're accountable for. The county gets 20.6%. The school district gets 39.2%. The rec department gets 1.5%. And the rec department is the same as the school district, so they're in effect getting 40.7%. Almost half of every dollar that people pay in taxes go to the school district. Not the city, not all of it, school district. LTC gets 5.9%. A lot of you don't know that Lakeshore Technical College levies against the average citizen and gets 5.9% of the tax levy. And the recreation is somehow buried in the school district, and they get that. Now, it's important to note that LTC and the recreation department, although they legally levy against the taxpayers, do not have their board members elected by the taxpayers. They're appointed by the school district officials and by the county officials. That's how that goes. Nonetheless, they still levy. And who knows, we can't forget the state, right? They get 0.07%. The state gets a little bit of our appropriation. So folks, I'll say it over and over and over again until I get blue in the face. Every dollar that people pay in taxes, 32.1% comes to us. The rest goes somewhere else. In addition to that, the people of Sheboygan are being levied about $13.5 million by the county. $13.5 million is being levied against our taxpayers by county. And some people are starting to wonder, what are we getting for it? Because they don't have to show an accounting of it. It's brought into the general operations, it's commingled, and it's appropriated. I don't know. Now, we've talked about a proposed rate reduction of 5 cents on the tax rate, which is $8.42 currently per thousand, which will drop to about $8.37 per thousand. What is that going to do? On the average, and we're looking at an average home now because of inflation and all that other stuff that factored into mortgages, an average $200,000 home will be paying about $10 less per year. It doesn't sound like a lot, but my wife is going to be jumping up and down because she's the type that pinches pennies, and 10 bucks is 10 bucks, folks. And we have over 2,300 and something dwellings in this community, and it's going to impact everybody in one way or another. Now, that's what it's going to do to the taxpayer. What's it going to do to us? When we reduce that rate, we collect less. One would think, one would be correct. The impact on our anticipated revenues will be approximately $126,000. we can absorb that. We can absorb it to prove to the taxpayers that when we talk about holding the line on taxes and reducing taxes, we're talking business. Now, the train has been moving forward. We stopped the train. We're causing it to go back by doing the 5 cent reduction. It's a major monumental step if you pass that resolution tonight, because that's still up for grabs. We have expenses that are going up. We know what we paid last year. We know we can mathematically figure out pretty well how much more our expenses are going to go up because of automatic increases in salary, wages, insurance premiums, lights, gas, gasoline. We know mathematically what those increases are going to be pretty close. So we need to look for alternative sources of revenue. We did that already, subject to a lot of controversy, with the ambulance, fire-base ambulance. We're expecting a good revenue, a non-traditional source of revenue to generate some additional revenue to make up for these increases in revenue, increases in expenditures, and so that we are able to maintain the current level of police and fire protection. That's key. Quite frankly, that's how Manitowoc did it. That's the only way they could keep up. We're also looking at anticipated revenues in municipal court. The decertification of the TIF district that's coming up is going to mean about $311,000, just our share, 32.1%, because when the TIF expires, although no other entity put any money up, as soon as it expires, they want their share. We get 32.1%, and then, as I said, the county gets 20.6, and the school district gets 39.2. But our share of the decertification of this TIF district that's expiring will translate to about $311,000 revenue additional that we didn't have last year. And that's because our increased value now has gone up about $40 million. So when we say that there hasn't been none, yes, there has. All you got to do is drive around town on the riverfront. There's been a lot. And we do expect our assessed valuation to be about $2.5 billion, which is great, which is about 2.5% increase. Not bad, folks. We're also hoping to realize some anticipated revenues from shared services. We're about that close to coming before the council to approve a joint venture, a shared service with the county on HR and the purchasing agent. We're pretty close. That's going to save a tremendous amount of money there, that there will be some carryover and money that does not have to be appropriated. Alderman Balk is here. Come on in, sir. And then we're also looking at possible anticipated revenues and some changes in our insurance as we did last year. So these are just some examples of where we can look for other sources of revenue to match our anticipated expenses that we see coming. But we don't have a deficit, folks. We don't have a deficit yet. We have a lot of uncertainties and a lot of preliminary numbers. And that's why I don't like to discuss preliminary numbers, because people hold me to them and say, but you said, well, that was preliminary. And this is why I have a little difficulty with outbursts in the newspaper, that like the paper printed. The sky is falling. We have a great deficit. Not yet. And not if I can help it. And I know not if you can help it. We're not going to have a deficit. Tonight's resolution that calls for layoffs, that calls for a hiring freeze, I should say, and that calls for a decrease in the tax rate, I support. When Alderman Hanna and I talk about that, we talk specifically about providing much anticipated and requested tax relief from the taxpayers. The word layoff has been mentioned, sometimes overly mentioned by the media. It's not happening yet. Those are alternatives. They're not realities. Alderman Hanna never talked about layoffs. We talked about tax relief to the public. They keep asking for it. And I would hope at some time the people would go to the school district, to the county, to LTC, to the rec department. Don't bother going to the state, I think, for 0.7%, but go to these other jurisdictions, folks, and express your feelings like people express their feelings here. We are doing our job. We are doing our job so incredibly well that because other people aren't really keeping up with us, our efforts go unnoticed, pretty much, or unappreciated. But that doesn't mean we need to stop doing what we're doing. So I challenge the other entities, do what we do. They'll feel, people will feel the difference in their pocket. They're going to feel less and less money being paid. Because tax relief, I really, really believe, doesn't just involve the city government. It involves the school, the county, it involves a concerted joint effort by all the taxing jurisdictions, including our elected officials from the state. It has to start over there, too. It has to stop with the unfunded mandate. It has to stop with decreasing your transportation aids. It has to stop with no more shared revenue. It has to stop. It has to stop with a lot of things the state has power to do. We have no control over, but we feel the ultimate impact. So it's not an effort that we can just say, well, the city, we're doing it. It's going to take more than us. But I think we've showed, and I hope we show again tonight, that we're serious about this tax relief to people. And again, the budget process has just begun, and it doesn't end until November 24th. That's the day you adopt the budget. In the meantime, I'm going to be meeting with department heads to address the additional expenses and to hopefully address the decrease in the tax rate that will be passed tonight. I ask you to please be patient. Let's work together as legislators and administrators to bring a good end to the additional expenses we're going to have this year, and we're going to have next year, and we're going to have next year, and we're going to continue to have. The next thing I'd like to speak to you a little bit about, just very briefly, committee roles and responsibilities. I've had some aldermen express some concerns, and it basically has to do with not every action the council take has to go to the committee of the whole. Not every action has to go to finance or to public protection and safety or to public works. I'm asking, let the committee do their work. You don't have, lately we were having multiple referrals because everybody's got to look at it. We need to trust the judgment of the standing committees. The people elected these individuals, they're doing their job the best they can, and then we need to take a look at that. They may have different answers than we do. That's just the way it goes. And it's important to me that we do that because I think that helps the morale. And then I would also point out to please work with me in avoiding, to the extent possible, legislative micromanagement. I have a lot of work to do. I'm working very hard with my department heads, and it's very difficult for me to work when they're out there doing other things because some alderman has asked them, do this for me right now. We can't, and it's not that blatant at times, but it's very difficult for me. And I will tell you, and I've told my department heads, I hold them accountable for the manner in which they conduct themselves and the manner in which they respond to me. I do evaluations, and that's when I look at those things. And then finally, code enforcer. For the public in particular, we've hired Roger Severson. He started working today, Monday. He will be in training for a few days. The learning curve is very small for this gentleman because he's very qualified, had great credentials. Paulette Anders and I feel that we could literally just put him out in the street, he'll be able to do his job, but we're still going to do some training. There's some training that needs to be done. But I would say that no later, maybe even towards the end of the week, but no later than next week, the code enforcer will be out in the public checking alleys, front yards, backyards, rules, anywhere that he can take a look at to see if the code is not being, it's being violated in terms of garbage. Now, this person that has been hired, Roger Severson, will do nothing but enforce the code. That's it. So, what is the effect of that? We're going to get people to call the alderman. I just got a citation, or I just got a warning, or I can't afford it. I can't afford it. I don't have a truck. At some point, people are going to find out it costs more money to keep garbage in your yard than it does to get rid of it. It doesn't have to be that way, but that's the way it will be for some. And we're not doing it to generate revenue. We're doing it because people plead with me, and they've pled with you, keep our city clean. And we have chronic people. chronic. They keep coming up. I mean, I get so frustrated when I have to ask building code inspectors, would you please send these people a letter? And they pull it out of a file that's got 30 of them already. These are chronic people. At some point, they're going to say, it's costing me too much money. I better get my yard clean. Now, we're going to have some funny quotes. I'll share one with you. One guy even told us, I didn't think you people were that serious. Folks, we're serious. We're cleaning up our city. And all it takes is a little effort on the homeowner's part and the landlord's part. It shouldn't cost any money. The only way it's going to cost money is if the yards aren't clean and kept clean. With that, I'll end it. We will move on to the consent agenda, 8.1 through 8.14, with the exception of 8.2, which we will refer back to committee of the whole. There's some issues on 8.2 that need to be resolved and discussed. And the best place to do it is at the committee of the whole, Alderman Bauck. So, 8.1 through 8.14, President Hanna.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd move that all ROs be accepted and placed on file, and all RCs be accepted and adopted.
Thank you very much. Is there a second? Vice President Bourne.
Thank you, Your Honor. Before I second Alderman Hanna's motion, I would like to hold part of document 8.8, the first item. That item number one was originally council document number 725. That went to public protection and safety, and they're asking it to be filed. However, because I've been unable to get the parties together for a law and licensing committee meeting, I will be getting the parties together for our law and licensing meeting on August 12th. I would like to hold number one on this document until the council meeting on August 18th, when law and licensing can report out.
Okay, please make a motion.
Make a motion to hold item number one on document 8.8 until August 18th.
Second. Motion and second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Again, consent agenda 8.1 through 14, with the exception of 8.8, which is being held, and 8.2, which is being referred to committee of the whole. Alderman Ryan, comments, sir?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would like to put 8.14 up for a separate vote. I need to make an amendment to it.
Okay, 8.14 will go for a separate vote. I need a motion from you, Alderman Ryan.
I would motion to
accept and adopt report of committee.
Accept and adopt the report of committee.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Okay. Under discussion, you can make your amendment now.
Okay. I would like to, under section 26-396 of this regarding retaining walls, I would like to eliminate third line down after where it says the provisions of this article. I would like to eliminate except for sections 26-395 and 26-396. 26395, and it formerly dealt with the height of fences, and 396 dealt with the setbacks. Now 395 in this document is the abatement of nuisance fences, and 396 is dealing with retaining walls. So we would just like to eliminate that to clean it up.
Is there a second to that amendment?
Second.
Second. Under discussion on the amendment, Alderman Ryan has discussed. Is there any more? Alderman Ryan? No? Okay. On the amendment only. You're done? Right, but are you done?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Now I need a motion to...
Motion to put the report of committee upon its passage as amended.
Motion and second. Under discussion. There being none, please call the roll on this one.
Bourne.
Aye.
Bauck.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hanna.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kleunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Verhassel.
Aye.
And Wongeman.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. Going back, consent agenda. There's been a motion and a second to approve 8.1 through 14 with the exception of 8.2 being referred back and 8.14 already acted on. Is there any discussion on the balance? There is none. Please call the roll.
Bauck.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hanna.
Aye.
Heideman.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kleunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweil.
Aye.
Verhasselt.
Aye.
Wongaman.
Aye.
And Boren.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. Report of officers two. We were holding 815 for 839. We were hold 816 for 838. We will hold 817 for 840, and we will hold 818 for 838. Items 8, 19 through 25 to be referred. Resolutions introduced 3, 826 by Alderman Hanna, creating a special committee on handheld mobile telephone use while driving a motor vehicle in the city of Sheboygan. President Hanna.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second.
Motion and second. Under discussion. President Hanna.
Thank you. This is just to formally study the issue so the public understands that there's been a request. We decided at Public Protection and Safety that it deserved to have a subcommittee look at it. There's a finite date where they'll report back to the Public Protection and Safety.
Good clarification. Thank you. Any other discussion? There is none. Please call the roll.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hanna.
Aye.
Heideman.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kleunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweil.
Aye.
Verhasselt.
Aye.
Wongaman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
And Bauck.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. 827 by Alderman Gisha and Hanna, establishing 209 budget guidelines. Alderman Gisha.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second.
Motion and second. Under discussion. President Hanna.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to offer a friendly amendment, a further resolve, if you will.
Yeah.
And this is in all due deference to Bill Bittner, one of our department heads. So further resolve that the current approved hirings by salary and grievances shall remain in full force and effect for a period of 2 weeks after the passage of this resolution.
Second.
Motion and second to amend, as noted. No?
That's okay. I'll have him repeat it.
Okay.
I even wrote it down this time. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Any discussion on Alderman Verhasselt?
I'm sorry, I don't have a question on the amendment.
No question on the amendment? Okay. Alderman Gisha on the amendment?
Yes, thank you. Not just to Bill Bittner, but actually it goes back to your comments in deference to our members on the Salary and Grievance Committee as well, who are in the process of doing certain hirings that were right there on the cusp. So in addition to Mr. Bittner, also our own committee.
Thank you, Alderman Gisha. Alderman Kleunis.
Thank you, Your Honor. I guess I just asking for clarification. I guess that helps why the 2 week only extension on it. Okay.
To my understanding that
it's in the process.
It's in process, and okay. It's just about completed.
All right. Thank you.
It's in the process, and we're sort of looking at Bill Bittner here and saying, get it done. Okay. Alderman Rindfleisch.
I guess because I haven't. Don't have a copy in front of me. Was it specific just to the Public Works Department for the 2 weeks?
It's.
I'm not aware of any other approved hirings by salary and grievances that are outstanding right now. So I guess by default it does, but I don't know of any others that are outstanding.
Let's check.
Okay. I did notice in the packet we have some additional ones, Public Works Assistants, right. And others. Is that included in that or is that not?
Whatever the Salary and Grievance Committee has approved that's in the process of being interviewed at the moment is included.
And that includes what's in today's packets, then? That includes what's in today's packets in the other matters? There's two positions there.
What are you talking about?
Position one is a Public Works Helper.
That's already been hired.
It's already been hired? And the position of was a mayoral assistant. Is this the last one
that's
on
been,
the?
She's been hired too.
That's also been hired. And that's been hired through salary grievances, or has that come through I guess,
no, that doesn't
this committee
come,
at all.
That was already approved by salary and grievance, and it's been filed pursuant to salary and grievance's instructions to use Schedule X.
Okay, and then has that come in front of the full council until today? I guess is the question. The question I have is, obviously, the 2 weeks that we're making the amendment for does not include what's already come in front of salary grievances, but whatever's come in front of salary grievances, this is the first I've seen of it. Does that make sense to everybody?
If they have, if those have been approved by salary grievance, which they have, they're included in this.
By that amendment, okay.
Now, we do have some other issues that are going to come up. For example, with the city engineer, and that, well, there is an exception in the document that says that in case, in extenuating circumstances, the mayor can approve and the council can approve, then it follows back the process that was in place already.
And I guess what I'm following through is with those, is it extenuating circumstances, emergency circumstance, or where is this? The other side of the issue is if it's not specific to public works, as long as it's something that's already been in the process, we're going to create a free-for-all of hire in the next 2 weeks, is my concern with that. Okay, then I will support that agreement, but I do have concerns regarding 765 and 766, the two positions that had not been in front of the council yet.
Well, Ed, you need to say something? Okay. Come up.
Thank you, Mayor and Common Council. I guess my question is, the city engineer position went through salaries and grievances, and we've advertised, and we're accepting applications. Do we have to go back through the process?
If you don't fill them in 2 weeks.
And I guess I just want to say as a department head that that's a critical position, and that could put us behind the eight ball.
What position is that, Paul?
City engineer.
You shouldn't have any difficulty with that, but there needs to be a policy in place, which I think Alderman Gish has made pretty clear. There is an exception to that in the event that we have instances with extenuating circumstances like this one, and in particular because our code requires that we have a city engineer. So that would be extenuating enough.
But it would be committee, two common council committee meetings. It could be a month to 6 week process?
That's the way I understand it. Okay, I got a lot of lights coming up. Alderman Gisha, I think you need to respond to that.
I'd be happy to address that. Thank you, Your Honor. The easy answer is yes, because the process, and I don't want to speak to the amendment because that's not what we're discussing. We're discussing the point of the amendment, and per that amendment, the answer is yes. It would have to go through the process. And department heads would be required to make a case, and we can discuss that during the amendment, that it is a emergency need, but if it's something by statute that we're required to have, obviously that would make that a very positive discussion in my personal opinion.
And to any expediency that may be afforded, it will be so afforded. Thank you. We have next, Alderman Wagman, you had light on, sir.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm deeply concerned about a hiring freeze. I'm worried we've got winter coming up, and if winter is anything like last winter, are we going to have enough people down there, especially the DPW? I know they're...
Point of order, we're talking about the amendment.
Yes, we're talking about the amendment.
Thank you, pardon.
Okay. Alderman Rindfleisch,
yep,
second time.
On the amendment. Thank you, Your Honor. I guess then, because we do already know that the city engineer position is an emergency one, we do know it's by code, it does seem to say that the language is there that it still must be approved by the mayor and city council to do so. That's in black and white. We still have to do the process of actually approving her to go ahead and apply for that so that she can go ahead and hire. I think it's a little difficult in the actual application time for someone to apply for a job that may or may not be technically there. So I would ask then if we're going to grant 2 week under the amendments for one department, simply add that position as well as one under the exception, because we're already looking at, within our budget, hiring that position anyway. Sort of a discussion to those, to the person that made the amendment. That will avoid that.
Absolutely. I would accept his additional language for that particular position.
What was your original language? You said a lot of things.
We haven't voted yet on the amendment.
Right, so he's adding a line to the amendment.
I would amend the amendment after it's voted upon, including that. However, since we haven't voted on it yet, I would simply ask that the person who made the motion to amend to change the motion, add that position. At least we can save ourselves one vote.
Are you in agreement with that?
I am absolutely in agreement with that.
And then friendly is acceptable.
Oh, absolutely.
Very friendly.
City engineer.
Very friendly. Yeah. Okay, city engineer's been added on.
Yep.
Okay. Anything else on the amendment? Please call a roll on the amendment.
Gisha?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
Heidemann?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Kleunis?
Aye.
Meyer?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Ryan?
Aye.
Surik?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Verhassel?
Aye.
Wongeman?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Bauck?
Aye.
And Decker?
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. Alderman Gisha, need a motion to approve as amended?
That's right. I make a motion to approve 827 as amended with the friendly amendment.
Thank you. Under discussion on the motion, Alderman Verhassel.
Thank you, Your Honor. Item number three on the now, therefore be it resolved, reads, emergency exceptions to the hiring freeze must be approved by the mayor, city council, and then follow the standard hiring process. Can I ask the two authors, is the assumption that the standard hiring process includes salary and grievance?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Excellent. All right. Thanks.
Yeah. It sure does. It goes right back to what's in place now. We have Alderman Ryan next.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You know, it's a difficult thing, a hiring freeze. But I think it's prudent that we do so. As we've heard tonight, we don't have a deficit next year. And you know, we can look at it that way, or we can start making some motions now to try to get things in line that indeed we don't have a deficit next year. Obviously, this is pretty well written that there are exceptions, key personnel. You know, when it comes time, it's a lot easier to have a hiring freeze than it is to have layoffs if need be. And unfortunately, normally when it comes to a lot of positions, it's last in, first out. So a lot of the people that may be hired between now and the end of the year may not have a job anyway. So, I mean, it's a good thing to do. It's a good preventive measure. It's fiscally prudent, and therefore I'll support it.
Thank you, Alderman Ryan. Next we have Alderman Wagman.
Thank you, Your Honor. As I started to say before, incorrectly apparently, the hiring freeze does concern me a great deal. As the gentleman spoke to before, people are worried about the infrastructure of our city. They're worried about, are we going to have enough people to do the jobs we need? I know right now the city is still desperately trying to clean up the trees and things that are down, and they're having a tough time doing it. And I'm really wondering that as people retire and so forth, if a hiring freeze is really in order. I hope we're not throwing the baby out with the bathwater. You know, it's just one of these situations that we have to try and decide, you know, do we owe the people service or do we owe them, as it was stated, being fiscally prudent? You know, of course we want to be fiscally prudent, but we also owe our citizens services. We owe them good streets and efficient garbage pickup. And I find it difficult to, especially with the winter months coming up now, and if we have another bad winter, we might be in deep trouble. Now we could go to an emergency process where we would hire people, but can you hire people who are qualified snowplow drivers and that sort of thing? I don't think you can just hire them off the street, you know. So this concerns me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Alderman, President Hannah.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And you're right, we do not have a deficit. We're in the early stages of the budget process. I felt it was important that we have this conversation as a collective body to kind of set the tone and support you in the budget process. I think it's very important that the council be unified behind you. You've got a monumental task ahead of you, as you had last year, and you'll have into the future. I think last year we dealt with setting the tone and the policy in June. This is a month later. And I just think that this is a prudent step to take. I think the document allows for us to fill emergency positions where needed. It also sends a message to the taxpayers that we're trying to be good stewards, that you've let us experiment. You let us do some things that other city councils may not have done. And I think giving a little bit back in terms of tax relief is kind of a thank you for taking a chance on some of our ideas.
Excellent point, Alderman Hanna. Alderman Rindfleisch.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think this is a lot of perhaps sound and fury that signifies very little. Because we are entering into the budget process, it does give us some strength to say, okay, where we're at in hiring, that's where we're going to be. And before we go towards the budget, that's a valuable tool. I think the rest of it, though, is number two. It's hiring freeze for all permanent full-time positions, not temporary, not seasonal, not part-time positions. It does create us some leeway that we can bring in people that, you know, either temporary, part-time, seasonal, that can fill in and to help the city operate, and emergency exceptions. There is no tried and true definition of what emergency is. So it does give us the opportunity to really kind of define that any which direction we can go. So I warn people that who may be terrified of this, I think it gives us a great tool to move forward upon. As the city is saying that we are going to hold the line in the budget, but those are terrified that the city will be in flames and burn down, is that no, we have given ourselves enough tools within this one to really make sure that the care of the city is upheld. So I will support this at this time. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Clevis.
Thank you, Your Honor. I appreciate the effort. I think 5 cents isn't a lot. 5 cents on 1,000 is not a lot. I think the other thing that I would hope this would do would be to have department heads think creatively about the way their department is run. That's even harder to do, to get a new mold, to get a new shape to a department. That could mean changes in scheduling, change in job responsibilities, efficiencies that maybe we don't want to look at. I think there's a big challenge here, not just, you know, tweak here, tweak there, a couple cents here, a couple cents there, to run a department in a whole different way would be a great accomplishment, I think, for all of our departments, because this is the 2008, and I would imagine some things are being done like 1950 in terms of maybe the way things are scheduled or whatever. So I would challenge department heads to really look at the big picture.
Thank you, Alderman Clevis, and that's exactly what we're going to be doing. It's an excellent point. I think department heads are already thinking in those lines, and I'm glad you bring that up because it's very important to hear. Alderman Gisha.
Oh,
one more time.
Sorry. Thank you. Just to address just a couple points, I've learned a lot from Alderperson Clayunas about sustainability, and that's kind of what we've talked about it in finance and things, and that's what we're doing here is to being able to sustain increases. $800,000 is the increase for employee expenses based on contracted raises and step increases for 2008 in our city budget, or pardon me, for 2009 in the future city budget. $800,000, that's already in place. Add debt service on the bond for the police station, add about $240,000 in costs for maintaining heating and lighting and cleaning the police station, which we desperately needed. I voted for the police station as well. Add increases in fuel, utilities, bing, 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 bing. I think we don't have a deficit. This is a kind of a general running discussion between Mayor Perez and Alderman Hanna and I. I don't think we have a deficit because nobody's added it all up yet. I think if you added it all up today, you'd say we have a deficit for the moment and needs to be fixed. We'll argue about that forever. 90% of our city budget is pay and benefits. Someone else mentioned that this is kind of very little when it comes to the hiring freeze and so forth. We can, because 90% of our budget is pay and benefits, we can also make up those amounts faster than cutting the cost of paper clips or turning off lighting, all very important things and things we should be watching, but we can gain these and fill this gap created by these additional expenses quicker. I agree wholeheartedly it's going to cause our department heads and the mayor, and I said it to the mayor when we were in discussions on this, is it's going to be a lot of work. And I think the department heads and the mayor are up to the challenge. Just a note regarding winter coming up and having people be afraid of winter with a hiring freeze. I think DPW is down 6 employees. They were down 6 employees for this last winter. So it's not like that as being a gutted situation. They handled it extremely well, much like the storm, with their current levels. We do have a lot of retirements coming up in the future. We look at the average age of our city employee, and we can make those decisions under emergency hires if those are key positions. But certainly there'll be a lot of administrative work, but that's why we have hired, I think, extremely skilled and qualified department heads. They're department heads. They know where they're, what they can do and what they can't, and they're very skilled to implement these things. And it's a big challenge to them and to the mayor, and I hope we can all support them in these very difficult efforts.
Thank you, Alderman Geisha. Okay, there are no more. There is no more discussion. Please call the roll.
Hannah.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kalyunas.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Verhassel.
Aye.
Wongeman.
No.
Boren.
Aye.
Bauch.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
And Geisha.
Aye.
15 ayes, 1 no.
Motion carries. 828 lies over. 829 through 834 to be referred. Report of committees 6, 835 by law and licensing, recommending denying beverage operators license number 7913 based on the applicant's failure to include all relevant convictions on the application, the record of violations related to the licensed activity, the record as a repeat law of a violator, and failure to cooperate with the committee. Vice President Bourne.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Motion and second. Under discussion?
Under discussion, is Ms. Angel Josh here tonight? She's not here, Your Honor.
Very well. Please proceed.
Ms. Josh had 2 opportunities to appear before our committee, one by certified mail. She did not appear, so failure to cooperate with the committee, and then the other violations that you mentioned, we decided to deny the license.
Thank you very much. Any other discussion? There being none, please call the roll.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kalyunas.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Verhassel.
Aye.
Wongeman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Bauch.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Geisha.
Aye.
And Hannah.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. 836 by Public Protection and Safety, recommending filing documents, submitting a communication from the Hmong Mutual Assistance Association of Sheboygan Incorporated, requesting permission to hold their Hmong Summer Festival on July 26th and 27th at Kiwanis Park, and to close off Kiwanis Park Drive through traffic to and from North 14th Street and North 17th Street, and approving all requests in their letter, and that's including the request of 2 uniformed police officers at the association's expense. President Hannah. Alderman Rindfleisch.
Thank you.
You were there.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Second. Motion and second. Under discussion. Alderman Geisha.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm just going to take this opportunity because this has a portion of it that answers that asks a question that I hear quite a bit regarding officers being paid by festivals. I see they're offered to pay for 2 uniformed police officers. I've been informed by finance that when that happens, that money then goes back into the police overtime budget when we receive the money from the festival that's using them. So like this festival and all other festivals, that's how the money comes back into the police department, because obviously we pay those folks, and then it comes back per finance.
I was told it went to a chief clerk's vacation fund.
That's just how it's
separate line item, Your Honor.
Thank you for the explanation, Alderman Geisha. Any other discussion on 836? Has it been motioned and second? There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 837 to be referred. Report of Committees 7, 838, and Vice President Boren will take 816 and 818, and that's by law and licensing, submitting the facts and findings in the matter of the quasi-judicial hearing regarding the alcohol beverage license number 2228 held by Kev and Blondie's Blue Phoenix, LLC, Kevin Nyhaus, agent, and beverage operator's license number 6196. Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. First, I'd like to take document number 818, and I'd like to make a motion to accept and file the report of officer.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and second under discussion. There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Then next, I'll take document number 816. And I would also like to make a motion to accept and file the report of officer.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and second. Under discussion. There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Please continue.
Next, I'll take document number 838. And on that one, I'd like to move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Motion and second to accept and adopt report of committee 838 under discussion.
Under discussion, Your Honor, after the quasi-judicial hearing on this matter, it was a unanimous decision by the committee to ask for a suspension of Mr. Nyhaus's beverage operator's license, his personal bartending license, for 30 days, and also 30 days on his liquor license with his establishment.
Thank you, Vice President Boren. Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. Perhaps my button wasn't working. We have a letter, 818, which we just filed, from the attorney, and 847 from the attorney regarding agenda item number 838 and 840. The letter from the attorney say that, I received notice that the committee's recommendation is scheduled to be presented tonight. I respectfully request that this matter be heard on a later date. I have yet to receive the committee report and will need additional time to adequately prepare for this presentation. And that has to do with shenanigans and with the Blue Phoenix vote. So I would make a motion to hold those two because of the letters from the attorney.
Motion and second to hold 838 and what else?
840.
840. Under discussion on the motion to hold, Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. Counsel for both establishments had notice that they were supposed to get the remarks into the city clerk's office by Thursday afternoon. Our city attorney followed through and got his documentation into the city clerk's office on time. The attorney for both establishments did have time to write a letter. And I disagree with the fact that he did not have enough time, and that if he had time to write a letter, to get this letter in, another few minutes or a couple of hours, he could have spent on this and still got the response in to the city clerk on time. Also, as been a procedure of the Law and Licensing Committee for many years, we do not accept any oral arguments in these matters, only written arguments.
Okay. Any further discussion on the motion to hold? And for clarification, Alderman Montemayor, hold for how long? Until next council meeting?
Until the next law and licensing meeting.
No, oh, it's I'm already sorry. Been there. Council meeting.
Council meeting. Council meeting. Council meeting.
Okay. Okay, the motion to hold. Attorney, would you like to address Vice President Boren? Hold on. You can't yet. Yes.
Your Honor, I object to opening up the floor to the attorney. If you're going to open up the floor to the attorney, then I want our counsel hired again for the counsel. I want to be able to call Attorney Adams and also the police department. We do not accept any oral arguments from the defense lawyer. It's past policy.
No.
Then we're going to have to do a complete new quasi-judicial hearing in front of the counsel. And I don't know if we want to go there.
And that's a very good point, Vice President Boren. The reason I asked the attorney if he wished to speak is because he was raising his hand, and the only way he can is for the floor to be open. Okay? We can't deny him that opportunity if the council opens the floor. So since he's raising his hand, does the council, is anybody here want to make a motion to open the floor? No one. Okay, so we don't hear. The motion is to hold till the next council meeting. It's all that's on I know, I see you. It's all that's on the plate right now. Alderman Rindfleisch.
Thank you.
I saw you. I wasn't trying to ignore you.
Oh, no, I just was pointing that I did wish to speak regarding that issue and not the previous issue. The process, I think, regarding the quasi-judicial hearing, I think needs to be clarified to all the persons that aren't necessarily in that situation or have not sat on that committee before, and for the public at home. What happens is if there is sufficient evidence of, lack of a better word, wrongdoing, the Law and Licensing Committee requests the presence of the people at a meeting. And if further discussion finds out that they seem to be unwilling or unable to fix the problem, the committee can request that they voluntarily turn in their license for a certain time frame, within a certain, for a certain number of days, for a certain time frame. If they choose not to do so and to proceed on, the next step would be a quasi-judicial hearing. It's quasi because there is no judge involved. The judge and the jury is the same. It is the same Law and Licensing Committee that asked for a voluntary turning in of the license itself. If that seems unfair, then that policy needs to be looked at, and perhaps we do hold the quasi-judicial hearings in front of the whole council. Be aware these things take a long time to do, but if we're not going to just accept the recommendation of the committee, then we need to redo the policy and go in that direction. If we're not going to go in that direction of holding the quasi-judicial hearing in front of all of us, then we should take the recommendation of the committee that has heard the evidence at this point in time. So a little bit of clarification regarding that, regarding holding it right now, is that the evidence has been heard, I believe. Keep in mind also, it is not a dramatic courtroom experience. It is all written documentation as well of both sides of the issue. And that written documentation is what is in front of us as well. So there's something to hear the whole court quasi-judicial hearing again. It's already there in front of us. So at this point, I would say let's take the recommendation of the committee. If we want to change the policy and hear it, then let's do that. But at this point in time, under our current policy, has been heard already within that committee. Thank you.
Okay. So we'll call a roll call, voice vote on the motion to hold, and that's it. If that fails, then we will proceed with the motion to accept and adopt report of committee. Alderman Verhassel, on the motion to hold.
Thank you, Your Honor. On the motion to hold, I guess just clarification, I'm hearing that there's precedent, or is it official policy, unofficial policy, that we don't allow oral arguments? Because the motion to hold is basically a vehicle to help bring that argument in front of us in 2 weeks, or 3 weeks rather, and I'm hearing that that's not possible. If that's the case, then I guess I would fall back to the original committee's decision.
Okay. Vice President Boren?
Thank you, Your Honor. Just to expand on what Alderman Rindfleisch said, these issues have been fully vetted at the committee level, fully vetted. And the attorney was aware that he had to get his remarks in by a certain amount of time. And if his law firm has to work 24/7 to get those in, he knew what the deadline was. Our assistant, a city attorney, who also is a very, very busy man, not only had to do the documents for this, but had to do the documents for several other ones. So I do not favor in delaying it. The Law and Licensing Committee has spent a number of hours on this through the process. And as Alderman Rindfleisch says, if you want to change the process and have all quasis in front of the full council, then that's fine. But that is not what the process is now. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Ryan.
This will be brief. Thank you. My question is, if the attorney representing these establishments were to have us hold this document and come in 2 weeks, now, does he have the right to speak, and do the if he does not have that right to speak under statutes or the rules of law and licensing, then it makes no sense to hold this. If he does, I mean, for the sake of his clients here, that you know, this is what we're really dealing with, is the individual tavern owners here and not the attorney himself. If he does have the right to speak, or they have the right to defend themselves, then I would support holding this. If they do not have that right, then there's no reason to hold it. We might as well pass it tonight.
The right to speak will be in the form of a legal memoranda, so to speak, presented to the council in advance. Council can review it.
That's, and that would be all that we would receive is...
Yes. Yes. Unless, of course, the council wants to come back and open the floor and all that kind of stuff, which is what I think Vice President Bourne has been trying to address. Alderman Rainflesh.
Second time. I'll try to clarify it again. Also, if you examine the memo regarding the incidences, at all three incidences, the parties involved reached a stipulation. Stipulation basically is, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm not an attorney, so please correct me if I'm wrong, but the agreement to the matters of the case, the facts at hand,
okay,
are true.
Okay, we're going right back into explaining everything.
But I'm saying it's within...
We might as well have the quasi-judicial hearing.
No, again. I'm saying for the all the persons here present, regarding the documents in front is, if you look at it, the documents are there. There is no other additional information brought forth that can be brought forth. They've already agreed that it's true. So I'm not sure what we're going to hear beyond that. What is it worth hiring, you know, our counsel again for the council, I guess, counsel for the city, and continuing on the hiring on as well, when I think the facts are there, the committee's done the fact finding, they've reached the agreement. I think we should go with what the committee says.
Alderman Montemayor, after that we'll take one more and then we're going to call a vote.
Thank you, Your Honor. I would expect that within 2 weeks, perhaps the defendant himself may want to speak, and I can't imagine we would deny that. Or if we would, perhaps the attorney would have written things for us to read.
Okay. One more and that's it. I'm going to call the vote. Vice President Bourne.
Thank you, Your Honor. To answer Alderperson Montemayor's question, no, the defendants would not have a chance to speak unless we opened it up and had a total quasi-judicial hearing, because the evidence has been heard, it's here for you to review, and we can't open it up to the attorney for all our oral arguments or the defendants, because then we've got to be able to provide both sides of the case again, because you're only going to be hearing one side. And I don't know if you want to go through that process of, you know, possibly spending an hour and a half on each one of these cases in addition to our regular council business. That's a decision you have to make, but this is the current process. The issues have been fully vented. Both the prosecutor and the defense have had an opportunity to present their written remarks, and we got a letter, perhaps not as lengthy as the defense would have liked, but they had the opportunity to get it in by Thursday noon. Thank you.
Okay, the motion is to hold. There was a motion to hold and a second. Alderman Verhessel, you still wish to hold your second on that one? You're going to withdraw your second. So there's a motion to hold. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Please call the roll.
Hold on. Are we calling the roll on both
838
and 840
yes.
to hold?
Yes.
All right. Kittleson. Clayunis?
No.
Meyer?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Rindfleisch?
No.
Ryan?
No.
Surik?
No.
Vanderweel?
No.
Verhassel?
No.
Wongeman?
No.
Boren?
No.
Decker?
No.
Gisha?
No.
Hannah?
No.
And Heidemann?
No.
2 ayes and 13 noes.
Motion fails. There's a motion to accept and adopt report of committee 838. Please call the roll.
Meyer?
No.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Ryan?
Aye.
Surik?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Verhassel?
Aye.
Wongeman?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Decker?
Aye.
Gisha?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
Heidemann?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
And Clayunis?
Aye.
14 ayes, 1 no.
Motion carries. 839, by law and licensing, submitting the facts and findings in the matter of the quasi-judicial hearing regarding the alcohol beverage license number 2521, held by Bureau Culinary Schools. Marcel Bureau Agent, Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. First, I'll take document number 815, and I'll make a motion to accept and file the report of officer.
Is there a second? Motion and second. Any discussion on the motion to file? There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Please proceed.
Thank you again, Your Honor. Next, I'll take document number 839, and I move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Is there a second? Second. Motion and second. Under discussion.
Under discussion, Your Honor, after the quasi-judicial hearing, again, this was a unanimous vote by the committee to do the license suspension for the Bureau of Culinary Arts. And I might add for the committee's information that Mr. Bureau has stepped forward today and surrendered his license at the clerk's office.
Thank you, Vice President Boren. On 839, to accept and adopt report of committee, please call the roll.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Verhasselt.
Aye.
Wongeman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hanna.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Klayunis.
Aye.
And Meyer.
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. 840, by law and licensing, submitting the facts and fines in the matter of a quasi-judicial hearing regarding the alcohol beverage license number 2459 held by Shenanigans Daiquiri Bar, LLC, Jeremy Jacobs, agent. Vice President Barn.
Thank you, Your Honor. First of all, I'll take document number 817, and I'll make a motion to accept and file the report of officer.
Second.
Motion and second. Under discussion? There being none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 840, continue.
Document number 840, Your Honor, I'll move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Motion and second. Under discussion.
Under discussion, Your Honor, I just want the council to know again that it was a unanimous decision by the committee to suspend the license for a period of 45 consecutive business days.
Thank you, Vice President Boren. There being no more discussion, please call the roll.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan. Surik.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Verhasselt.
Aye.
Wongeman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hanna.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Klayunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
No.
And Montemayor.
Aye.
14 ayes, 1 no.
Motion carries. 841, by law and licensing, recommending and granting various licenses. Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'll move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Motion and second. Under discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 842, by law and licensing, recommending denying beverage operators license number 7934 based on the applicant's failure to include all relevant convictions on the beverage operator's license application, the record of violations related to the license activity, and the record as a repeat law violator. Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Second. Motion and second. Under discussion.
Under discussion, is Eric Schrader here tonight? Mr. Schrader is here, Your Honor.
Mr. Schrader, would you like to address the council? Please step forward.
Your Honor, if you don't mind, I'll
yes,
go.
Please continue. Hold on.
I'm going to report to the council the information that we received on Mr. Schrader, who did appear at our law and licensing meeting last Tuesday night. Mr. Schrader revealed a 2006 ordinance conviction for underage alcohol, a 2006 traffic conviction for absolute sobriety, and a 2008 ordinance conviction for underage alcohol. The record of conviction should have revealed as follows. Underage alcohol, 2006. Absolute sobriety, 2006. Obstructing, 2007. And underage alcohol, 2008. Mr. Schrader should have revealed all convictions. This was his first opportunity to appear before us. Mr. Schrader owes $452 to the municipal court that must be paid before the license may be issued, if granted. Three of the violations are directly related and occurred within the last 3 years. Therefore, based on his repeated violations related to the licensed activity and his status as a repeat law violator, it was the recommendation of Attorney Adams to deny the license.
Thank you. Please.
First, I'd like to say thank you for seeing me. I have been in trouble in the past. As you can tell, past years, with the obstruction, I really just forgot. I knew going in for the application, I need to tell them about all my fines, all my wrongdoings, and it just slipped my mind. I have been trying to stay out of trouble. I slipped up this past year, a couple months ago, and got in trouble with the law. I'm living with my brother and two roommates, so I'm working and trying to pay bills, so I really can't afford to get in any more trouble. I'm looking towards paying all my fines off and just bettering myself. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the motion is to accept and adopt the report of committee 842. Please call the roll.
Ryan?
No.
Surik?
Aye.
Vanderweil?
Aye.
Verhassel?
Aye.
Wongeman?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Decker?
No.
Gisha?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
Excuse me?
Aye.
Thank you. Heidemann?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Kliunas?
Aye.
Meyer?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
And Rindfleisch?
Aye.
13 ayes, 2 noes.
Motion carries. The license has been denied. 843, by law and licensing, recommending granting the change of premise for Ashley's Bar and Grill with the caveat that the city clerk receives proofs from the owner of a lot that he gives permission for them to use the property for their event. Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Motion and second. Under discussion. There is none. Please call the roll.
Surik?
Aye.
Vanderweil?
Aye.
Verhassel?
Aye.
Wongeman?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Decker?
Aye.
Gisha?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
Heidemann?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Kliunas?
Aye.
Meyer?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
And Ryan?
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. 844, by finance, recommending authorizing a transfer of appropriations in the 2008 budget, establish an appropriation for police department training from a donation from Walmart donation, excuse me, from Dave and Judy French for police department vehicles and a grant from the U.S. Department of Justice for police uniform vests. Alderman Gisha.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted and the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second. Motion and second. Under discussion. There is none. Please call the roll.
Vanderweil? Verhasselt,
aye.
Wongeman,
aye.
Boren,
aye.
Decker,
aye.
Gisha,
aye.
Hannah,
aye.
Heidemann,
aye.
Kittleson,
aye.
Kliunas,
aye.
Meyer,
aye.
Montemayor,
aye.
Rindfleisch,
aye.
Ryan,
aye.
And Surik,
aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. Ordinance is introduced 10, 845, lies over, 846 to be referred. Matters laid over 11, 727, RO number 103-0809 by the Redevelopment Authority regarding the former Kingsbury property at 739 North Water Street. The authority is currently evaluating 4 development proposals for the site. Before remediation of the site can occur, utilizing various grant funding, an environmental consultant must be secured to do necessary environmental studies and consult on environmental issues that may be incurred during excavation and construction. The Redevelopment Authority is recommending contracting the Sigma Group for a total compensation of $47,431. Alderman Ryan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that the RO be put upon its passage.
Motion and second. And that is to accept and file.
Accept and file.
Motion and Alderman Montemayor. Motion and second, under discussion. There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 759 RO number 104-0809 by the Board of Electrical Examiners submitting electrical contractors licenses which have been issued. Is that you, Alderman Rindfleisch? Who's it? Alderman Kittleson. Please, Alderman Kittleson, you're on.
I would make a motion that we put the...
Accept and file.
Oh, to accept and file the document.
Motion to accept and file. Is there a second? Second. Under discussion? There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. 745, resolution number 680809 by Alderman Gisha, authorizing the appropriate city officials to execute a dock space agreement. Alderman Gisha.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second. Motion and second. Under discussion? There is none. All in favor, please call the roll.
Vanderwil.
Aye.
Verhassel.
Aye.
Wongeman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hannah.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kleunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
And Surik.
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. 746, resolution number 690809 by Alderman Gisha, Kleunis, Boren, Bauk, and Montemayor, authorizing a transfer of appropriations in the 2008 budget, establishing revenue and appropriation for funds received for drug enforcement. Alderman Gisha.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second. Motion and second. Under discussion? There is none. Please call the roll.
Verhassel.
Aye.
Wongeman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hannah.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kleunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
And Vanderwiel.
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. 763, resolution number 700809 by Alderman Boren, authorizing the city attorney to engage the services of special outside legal counsel in regards to the quasi-judicial hearings for Bureau Culinary Schools and Shenanigan Daiquiri Bar, LLC. Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Motion and second. Any discussion? There is none. Please call the roll.
Wongeman.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Gisha.
Aye.
Hannah.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Kleunis.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Ryan.
Aye.
Surik.
Aye.
Vanderwiel.
Aye.
And Verhassel.
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. 764 RC number 133-0809 by City County Shared Services, recommending filing documents, submitting a communication from the Chairman of the Law Committee of Sheboygan County regarding the matter of joint dispatch and stating concerns that the city is moving to change its software provider, which will significantly impact the ability of the Sheriff's Department and Police Department to continue to share services that currently exist, which leads the Law Committee to question the commitment of shared services. And that was a mouthful. Thank Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the RC is accepted and filed.
Motion and second. Under discussion? Alderman Rindfleisch.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was not able to attend that meeting, and it's something of great concern to me. As I often speak in this committee here, it should be obvious that it's something that I'm concerned about. Not having been there, however, though, it concerns me to read in the statement from the City County Shared Services, not only regarding the concerns regarding the technology that the city would like to purchase, but specifically, where it is here, concerns that the county absorbing the full cost associated with this endeavor, this oversight procedures, control, and location have not been adequately addressed, and feeling that the city is moving to change a software provider, which again, I said, I get that, I understand that there's a concern regarding that. But the first part about that is, isn't that what we've discussed and passed, that I said we took away previously our commitment to only making them pay for the entire amount and looking into a more equitable statement, and if someone's come back to me and say, no, if the city isn't going to pay a half. Well, we just heard, beginning of this meeting, that out of every dollar that a city taxpayer pays, two-thirds or half of that goes to the county. It doesn't go to the city itself, or I'm sorry, it was 40%, correct? You know, that only the city dollars is a portion of that amount. And if we're going to have a full accounting of the county is enjoying some of the benefits, they should definitely sit back and look at how do we better equitably pay for that. The 50-50 split does not make sense, never has made sense. But I think this council is on record saying we're not asking for 100% for them anymore. And so I'm surprised to see why that language is back in here from that committee. Thank you.
And there again, I think there was a document that was laying over from previous time, and it needs to be filed, and so we're acting on President Hannah. It's carryover.
Yes, it is carryover, and the spirit of cooperation is much improved.
Thank you. Okay, on filing the document, 764, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 767, RC number 136-0809. By City County Shared Services, recommending filing resolution number 410809 by Alderman Verhassel and Boren, authorizing the city to initiate a shared services study with the Sheboygan County government for the purposes of determining the most cost-effective, efficient location for a joint emergency dispatch. Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the RSC be accepted and filed and the resolution be placed on file.
Motion and second.
Second.
Accept and adopt RSC. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 765, General Ordinance number 330908 by Alderman Montemayor, Surik, Meyer, Decker, and Verhassel, amending the municipal code so as to include a change to pay Schedule X, Class Grade 34, to add new title, position title, Mayoral Administrative Office. Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that the ordinance be put upon its passage.
Motion and second. Under discussion, Alderman Boren, Vice President Boren.
Thank you, Your Honor. Two questions. Number one, I noticed on the original document before we got the corrected copy that there were only two signatures from the Salary and Grievance Committee on that document. Was that just that the other aldermen didn't get a chance to sign it, or was there not enough support from the committee to get more signatures than the two?
I think they probably just didn't get a chance to sign it, right, Alderman Surik?
Yeah. And then my second question on this one is the position under Schedule X as Mayoral Administrative Officer. Is that position? I know the position was recently filled. Is that position now consist of a college degree as one of the criteria? Or is it a high school diploma currently?
No, the criteria stayed the same. The person that was hired has a college degree in political science.
Okay, so that's a job requirement then?
Yes.
Under that position? Thank
yes.
you, Your Honor.
Mm-hmm. Alderman Montemayor?
I'm sorry. You answered my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman. Okay, thank you. Alderman Gisha?
Thank you, Your Honor. Is it based on your comments at the beginning of the meeting of the momentum with the HR department in integrating it with the county under shared services? Just a clarification that if that does happen, I assume Ms. Hart moves back up to administrative assistant. This is a Schedule X, which is temporary, my understanding, no benefits. And that position would just, that person would then, because it's a temporary position, would just no longer be scheduled.
Is that
accurate?
It's accurate, Alderman Gisha. The individual, Becky Breese, who was hired and interviewed with the clear understanding that that position is not a permanent position, and the event that the HR position does get worked out with the county, Susan Hart would come back to the mayor's office and that person would step aside.
Thank you.
Alderman Verhassel.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just to clarify again, this was in committee back probably, I'm guessing, 2 months ago, something like that. So we don't, the original document isn't here, but I recall that we removed the four-year requirement at that time. I know the individual hired and in place as of today does have, I understand that. For your degree, but I recall that we lessened the requirements to make it easier to fill. We have to pay the same, and that was the issue that I had with it at that time. So I just give clarification.
Okay.
That currently, a four-year degree is the requirement.
The four-year degree is a requirement, yes, and that's what I hired, somebody with the four-year degree. Yes. Alderman Montemayor?
Thank you, Your Honor. That's all I was going to say. I remember that discussion at Salary and Grievance slightly different, that we discussed removing that requirement, but I think we ended up keeping it.
Well, it doesn't matter at this
right.
point because the person has.
Right.
Okay, we will act on the 765. Please call the roll.
Boren?
No.
Decker?
Aye.
Excuse me?
Aye.
Thank you. Gisha?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
Heidemann?
No.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Kleunis?
Aye.
Meyer?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
No.
Ryan?
No.
Surik?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Verhassel?
No.
Wongeman?
No.
Nine ayes, six noes.
Motion carries. All the matters authorized by law. Attorney McLean.
You've got another ordinance.
I'm sorry, what?
You have another ordinance.
Where? Oh, 766. General Ordinance number 34809 by Alderman Montemayor, Surik, Meyer, Decker, and Verhassel, amending the municipal code so as to include changes to pay schedule Y and class grade 23 to add new title extra help Department of Public Works. Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move the ordinance be put upon its passage.
Motion and second?
Second.
Second. Under discussion.
Pay schedule Y is X for the rest of the city. It means part-time and no benefits.
Alderman Rindfleisch.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My question regarding the five steps begins at step one, $10, $11, $12, $13, step four, and then $25 for step five. I haven't seen a large jump in that aspect. If someone from the Salary and Grievances Committee could explain what the jump is between step four and five and who that would pertain to. Thank you.
We'll do a little better than that. We'll call Bill Bittner.
This is an evolution out of something that came actually out of the Finance Committee back after the adoption of the 08 budget. We talked about adding people and what we could do. We made some cost changes. And one of the things I suggested in one of the memos to them that in making some budget changes, we actually add a little bit of dollars to temporary employees and change the flexibility from the traditional summer three-month employee to using some of the local talent, retired people, et cetera, and maybe get some of our work done very cost-effectively by using talent available always on a temporary or part-time basis, which by definition is under 600 hours a year. But we want it to be very flexible. This is an evolution of that, and the rate structure is very flexible because you would find people who are available at a flexible rate and pay them according to the job they're doing. That could be clerical, that could be management of coordinating something that you only coordinate for 5 hours a week. That could be basic labor. And so the structure is to allow that flexibility. It's never been envisioned that a particular person would move from the numbers you talked about, the relatively base labor, summer temporary kind of help, all the way up to perhaps a professional, but it was that we start using and manage temporary and part-time people in a more flexible way to try to save up some dollars.
Okay, please call the roll.
Decker?
Aye.
Gisha?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
Heidemann?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Kleunis?
Aye.
Meyer?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Ryan?
Aye.
Surik?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Verhassel?
Aye.
Wongeman?
Aye.
And Boren?
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. All the matters. Attorney McLean.
847 is an RO by the City Clerk's communication from Ryan Kautzer of Holly Kaufman and Kautzer stating that Shenanigans Bar LLC objects to the findings and recommendations made by the Law and Licensing Committee and requests the opportunity to provide oral and written arguments before the full Common Council.
We can't act on it. It's going to be referred to Law and Licensing.
Okay.
Next.
848, an RO by the City Clerk submitting various license applications for the period ending June 30, 2008, June 30, 2009, and June
30, 2010. That will go to Law and Licensing. Need a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Stand up.